Stanford University.
This is the fourth, I think. Is this the fourth of our SITP, that stands for Stanford Institute for Theoretical Physics, Stanford our mini courses. Stanford Institute for Theoretical Physics, for fundamental physics. That's what Stanford Institute is all about. Very fundamental aspects of theoretical physics in this case. And we cover a wide variety of different aspects, but all about what it is that makes the world work, why the world is the way it is. Cosmology, elementary particles, gravity and quantum mechanics, condensed matter physics, and just quantum mechanics itself. What's condensed matter physics? Condensed matter physics, that sounds like a very applied kind of thing, how you make things out of materials and so forth. No, it is really about how microscopic things emerge together to create the matter that we see in the real world. And so all of these things are really about very, very fundamental aspects of nature. And many of them are quite remote. elementary particle physics is remote. It's about things which are so small that, believe me, you can't see them. Things which are so big, maybe the universe, which is so big that you can't really get a look at it. It's very remote. And so one might ask, why do we do it? We don't do it for the applications. However, if history is any guide, and I think it is, I would say it's almost certain that the lessons that we learn about how the universe works, or how the world works, how elementary particles work, will eventually come together and create new applications, new technology. But that's not why we do it. We do it for two reasons. One is just plain, well, I think there's three reasons. One is simply curiosity. We really want to know how the world works. The other is the fun of discovery, the chase, if you like, the fun of discovery and the fun of discovering new things. The third, I'm afraid to say, is a little bit of ego, but let's leave that out of it. We all want to be famous. Curiosity and the excitement and fun of discovery. What is this talk about and what are these lectures about? They're really our outreach, but the purpose was and is to help you and the outside world share in the fun and excitement of the discoveries that physics is making. The people who will bring you these things, people like Leonardo, people like Savas Demopoulos, who was Savas the last one?
Yeah.
Sean Hartnell, and so forth. These people are not professional performers by any means. They are the real McCoy. They are the people in the trenches, the people who are really creating modern physics. And I hope that some of this excitement, some of this enthusiasm for the subject comes across from the lectures. So in any case, welcome to SITP's fourth two-part mini course on, in this case, the biggest of all subjects, cosmology, how the universe got to be the way it is. Tonight we have Leonardo Senatori. He's the other LS in the physics department. He had a Leonard S in the physics department. And in fact, as it happens, my actual birth certificate name is Leonardo, so the two of us are the Leonardos of the physics department. Leonardo, does Senatori mean senator?
Yes.
What a disgraceful name to have. No, the only reason I say that is because right now I'm reading about the Roman Empire. And there was some senators there too. Anyway, Leonardo is truly one of the absolute leaders in modern cosmology today. I won't tell you very much about him other than to say that he is a great physicist, highly honored, prizes, and all that kind of thing. and we're very fortunate to have him to tell us about. What's the title again?
It's called Empty University.
That's University, right?
Yes.
Right.
The beginning of the universe.
Right. Donald Trump created the greatest universe. You know.
So, thank you very much for the introduction and for coming. Yeah, these two lectures are about cosmology, which is the study of the way how the universe happened, became the way it is now. And this is one of the most essential questions that every human being poses to himself. For example, this is a nice picture that tends to represent the curiosity of human beings that try to explore beyond what is currently known. But actually, this is really the truth, because immediately after science in the modern term was defined by Galileo, the first thing, as soon as they had an instrument, a scientific instrument, which was the telescope, it was immediately pointed to the outer universe. It wasn't that far. It was the solar system. But for that time, it was incredibly far. So cosmology was one of the first subjects in physics. But then after the first explorations, for a couple of centuries, he laid a bit idle. Because as I will explain, cosmology is slightly different than the rest of physics. And basically, it was very difficult to make cosmological observation for a couple of centuries. So people focused on doing experiments in the laboratory. But starting from the 30s and really from the 50s of the former centuries, cosmology really blossomed, mainly thanks to the new experimental possibilities. For example, now we have satellites. The one on the left is the Planck satellite, and also many refined experiments in the South Pole or in Chile, which with great sensitivity allows us to explore the beginning of the universe. Now, so cosmology has reblossomed again in about 60 years ago. But understanding how the universe was born, it's also a question which is not so trivial to answer. And not just because maybe it's difficult what happened at the beginning of the universe, but it's also a very difficult operative question. We usually do physics by performing experiments, and the theoretical physicists try to explain how the experiment happens. In cosmology, it's very hard to make an experiment. We cannot reproduce the Big Bang in the tabletop experiment. It's pretty hard to. So this creates some difficulties because usually in physics, the point of physics is to explain the dynamics of events. For example, if you take two particles going to each other, they will collide, do some bang, and come out in some way. And usually our purpose is to explain, given a certain initial state, how things evolve. But in the universe, we don't have this luxury. We don't have the luxury of creating a universe the way we like. The universe is given, and we have to take it for what it is. So this experiment, this is instead the way physics normally proceed. Sometimes we do physics, this kind of experiment in our mind. These are called Gedanken experiments, which are very useful conceptually. But again, it's always this setup. Let's set up an initial state and let things evolve. In cosmology, instead, the initial state is given. We cannot change it. We cannot play with that. So this creates two problems, two things that makes exploration of the early universe very non-trivial. Because first of all, we have to just look at the one universe that is given to us. And this means that if, for example, we were living in a dusty galaxy, we would look at the sky and we would see nothing. We would see a wall of dust in front of us. We wouldn't see the extra galaxies. And there are galaxies like this. So if we were to live in such a galaxy, cosmology would not even born. So we're lucky that we live in a place which is suitable to cosmology. Also, it is a bit difficult, peculiar, the study of cosmology, because when we study cosmology, we study the very early universe. which is a very unusual place. As you will see, it's a place which is very, very energetic, very, where, and since we cannot do experiments over there, we simply have to use the laws of physics that were established in experiments on Earth in a very unusual setup. So we will often extrapolate our laws of physics beyond where they were normally taken. And this it's useful for two reasons. First of all, because if we believe our laws, we can learn how the universe was born, as we will see. But also, it offers a way to explore what are the laws of physics in unusual circumstances. For example, very high energies and very high, strange state of matters, high densities, high temperatures. Now, when we do cosmology in this course, it will be a very important concept, the fact that light travels at finite speed. And this means that when we look at things apart from us, we are not looking them at how they look now. We look at them when they emitted their light, which was 10 times ago. That is, if we are here, this is us, and there is a galaxy here, it's called Galaxy One, and this is, for example, space. When we see if we see the light here of the galaxy, it wasn't emitted now, because otherwise the speed of light to get to here immediately would be infinite. But actually, it was emitted some earlier time. So if I put time here, this galaxy here, we see some initial earlier time here, so that the light that was emitted by this galaxy reached us now. If you want to see a point which is farther away, we don't have the luxury of seeing it now. Ah, thank you. We see it in the past. So a point even more farther away, we cannot see it now. We don't see it at the same time of the former galaxy. We see it even in earlier times. So that light could have reached us out, because we do observation now. So this clearly creates a bit of a peculiarity, because you can see that we don't see the evolution of a given point of space at all times, but we see each point at a given specific time. So the way we can understand how the full universe evolved is only by gluing this piece together, of which we have only essentially a limited information. Each point is seen all at one time. And the way we will do cosmology is we will assume that the universe is homogeneous, and more or less what happens here has the same property that what happens here and what happens here. So that if you glue the history of all these points, we think that this represents more or less the history of what happened around us. So this is the way cosmological observations work, and the way we reconstruct the history of the universe. So we will do this in this class in detail. Please ask questions, please. And also, sometimes my accent is not really British, tends to be Italian. So even if you don't just understand the word, please feel free to ask. Okay, the first important thing to notice about the universe is that the universe is expanding. That is, if you see a galaxy, if this is us, and the galaxy here, we see it, actually we saw it a bit in the past, it's actually receding to us with some velocity, from us with some velocities. And then if you see another galaxy, we saw it a bit in earlier time, and we see that the velocity is even a bit larger. So points, galaxies are running away from us, and the farther they are away, the faster they run away from us. So how can this be possible? So there are two options. Either we live in a special place of the universe, such that we are at the center of the universe and everything is flowing from us. So basically what we see here, it's us, and then all galaxies receding like this with some velocity, and then the farther they are, they recede even more. Of course, it could be that we are at the center of the universe, even though history, especially in the Middle Ages, taught us that this is not the best approach to take. Instead, there is another possibility. A possibility is that the space itself is expanding. And if the space itself is expanding, it will turn out to be the case that every point in the space sees galaxies receding from itself with this property. So every point in space will be will see the same effect, which is very nice because it wouldn't assume that we are a special point, because in the moment we assume a special point, since we don't see the history of our point at all times, we're kind of stuck. So, but this is actually possible, and it's very compatible with the laws of physics. How is it possible? Before explaining the laws of physics, I will do it with a famous experiment. So this is, let's take a balloon, and let's inflate it, OK? So I'm a theoretical physicist, so experiments, let's see if it works. OK, now I will blow it more. And if you imagine that, so this is, imagine that this is the universe. How can you imagine that this is the universe? Well, this is, the problem is that this is bidimensional. They are jolly two-dimensional. We clearly live in three dimensions. But if you imagine that there is some laws of physics for which there are some bacteria living on this surface, and they only communicate with forces that cannot go on this direction. So bacteria cannot live in this direction. Their light cannot live in this direction. If this is the case, they would never know that there is a third dimension. They would just think that they live in two dimensions, very much like us on Earth. If we don't look up in the sky, we think we live in a bidimensional world. So as you can see that if I blow this balloon, each point recedes from another with a distance, with a velocity which is proportional to the distance from each other. In fact, we can even draw some galaxies here. Okay, I see. It's too important for science to do it, so we'll take the risk. So if you put two galaxies here, let's see. You can see that galaxies between from these two points, as we blow it, this galaxy recede from the other. But clearly, this is almost a perfect fiat. There is no privileged points. That is, what this galaxy sees is the same as this galaxy sees, the same as this galaxy is. This is a perfect isotropic space. Isotropic means, and homogeneous means that it's the same if you rotate it or if you translate it anywhere on this surface. It's the same, and every point expands in the same way. Now, the only inconvenience of this example is there are two. One is that looks like the galaxy expands. Instead, as the universe recedes, expands, galaxies do not expand because galaxies are bound together by a strong gravitational force that don't let them expand. So the galaxies are more like this. The coin, okay, this doesn't stick. The coin on this. That is, now if I blow this balloon, you will see that the coin does not deform. This is because coin has strong binding energy that makes it not feel the expansion of the universe. So galaxies, or the solar system, does not expand with time. But as you go between very far away galaxies that are not bound together, they recede like in this balloon. Now, this balloon is a bidimensional example. And as I was explaining, to understand it, one has to think that there are bacteria that don't see up or down. But because a natural question is to wonder, with what these examples are not perfect, otherwise they would be the truth. So this is just an analogy. The problem of this analogy is that it looks like that the balloon is expanding in an external space. And instead, it does not need to be the case. The space that is expanding can expand into itself. Simply space expands, but doesn't expand into something. This can be, maybe I have another example, maybe that helps for that. This is bread raising. It's Italian panettone. It's a bit more tasteful, I think, than raising bread, but it's the same concept. So you can imagine that these fruit, which is candies, are like galaxies. And as the bread is levitating, each galaxy gets farther and farther away. Now, this is expanding in three dimensions. It grows, it's expanding in three dimensions. Now, imagine that you are inside a gigantic panettone. So this is how it looks at the end. Imagine that you are inside a gigantic bread. And as time goes, this bread grows. And now make the bread infinite. That this bread is growing in three dimensions. All the candies are receding away with a speed which is proportional to the distance, growing into nothing. So it's like this. You as time goes on, this becomes larger and larger and larger. Okay. So, okay. It's dinner time. It helps to see something like this. Okay. So this observation, together with the fact that we don't live in a special point, implies that the space is expanding. How is it possible that it's expanding? Well, this is very compatible with the laws of physics, as we understand it. It's very compatible with the laws of general relativity. They were established about a century. Actually, we celebrated the 100 years ago, the 100-year birthday of general relativity exactly a few months ago. So according to general relativity, general relativity thinks that generalizes what Newton had done. General relativity, Newton basically said that there is a force of gravity. If you have two objects, one with a big mass and one with a little mass, there is a force between these two objects, which is the Newton constant times little mass times big mass over r squared, which r is the distance between the two objects. Now, this force was generalized by Einstein because clearly this force violated the laws of special relativity. It was an instantaneous force and was not acceptable. And Einstein generalized it in a beautiful way by saying that actually gravity is a fake force. That is, gravity can be, instead of thinking that gravity is a force between two particles, the way a second particle feels the gravity of another particle is that the big particle sits in space, and actually space can be deformed, a bit like if you are in an elastic carpet. Space gets deformed, and the second particle doesn't feel a force from the second particle. It simply moves in this space, which now is curved, and the straight trajectory that are straight in a non-curved space, in a curved space are different. For example, if there is a space which is bent a bit like this, then actually straight trajectory are ellipses like this. So the orbit of a planet around a big star is interpreted as the closed straight trajectory that happen to be around a star due to the curvature of space-time induced by the star. Not only space is curved, it's space-time, because according to special relativity, time and space are almost the same thing, and it's impossible to bend space without bending time. Everything needs to be bendable. Of course, if you have a static configuration, only one can think only of space being bent. So this is Newton, and this is Einstein, GR. General relativity. And now, the fact that, so in general relativity, space is curved, is dynamical, is bent. Now, the fact that gravity, however, is an attractive force, as we know, really wants, the moment you declare that the space can move, can do something, really it wants to be non-static. So the fact that gravity is attractive means that if you have a space that can be deformed by matter, and since gravity is attractive, all this matter would like to go together. So it's very hard in general relativity to make a static configuration, a configuration where two objects stay here and stay here forever. They would like to go together, and all space would like to go together, or maybe far away. They want to do something. They don't want to stay there, because if they're stuck, they go together. This means once you apply this to the universe, it tells you immediately that the universe cannot be eternal. Because if it's moving, it's coming from somewhere, it's going somewhere. So the static universe is immediately put to an end as this realization is made. Now let's go a little bit more in detail. Now, according to Einstein, this picture is in formula tell us that is written as a famous equation, G mu nu equal the Newton constant times T mu nu. Now, T mu nu is, roughly speaking, the energy density of matter. Energy density. And this G mu nu is a measure of how space is curved. So it's curvature of space-time. And there is a proportionality constant, which is called the Newton constant, which is more or less equal to, we call it sometimes 1 over the Planck mass square, because it's the units of 1 over mass. And this M Planck is a very, 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 very big number. Now, this equation tells you that energy is, tells you this. Energy curves space. Now, if you look at the universe, maybe I have a picture here. If you, OK, let's apply this equation, the equation of generativity, to the universe. Now, the universe, you can see, if you look very nearby, it looks very, very, in the, on the top on the left, it looks very, very inhomogeneous. There is a galaxy here. There is a completely empty space here. OK? But if you look a bit on larger scale, this is the Hubble deep spilled picture. It's a very, very big picture of very deep universe. You can see that there are many, many galaxies. And now you can see that almost all point looks a bit like the same. Now, if you look at even longer pictures, the one on the right, is a picture, is a map of all the galaxies that we know of in the universe. It was performed by an experiment called Sloan Digital Sky Survey. We will come back to that later. But it's a picture of all the galaxies. Almost 360 degrees, you see there are two edges because the telescope didn't look in some places on the sky. But you can see that it goes very, very far away. And you can see that the top part is more or less the same as the bottom part. There are some inhomogeneity. There are some clump of matter. But roughly, it is the same. It looks the same in every place. So it's very reasonable to assume that the universe is homogeneous. That is, in each location, is the same. As I told you, it's also essential for us to be able to do draw any experimental conclusion. Now, the moment the universe, we assume that the universe is homogeneous, things simplify a lot. In fact, the space-time can be represented. So space-time can be represented as a time coordinate times a spatial surface. That is, at each point, you can specify three coordinates, x, the leave on space, and the time. This is each point. And the three coordinates live in an homogeneous space. And there are only three kinds of homogeneous space. Now, if you live in two dimensions, an homogeneous space would be like an infinite plane. So this is an homogeneous plane in two dimensions. It's the same everywhere. In 3D, it becomes like this. It's like a cube, where these lines represent the coordinates. I can say this is x, this is y, this is x1, x2, x3, very simple, y1, y2, y3, etc. Now, however, there are other two kinds of universe that can be. It can be a sphere. OK, this is a sphere. It's called S2. This is also homogeneous. It's the balloon that I drew before. Every point is the same. There is no privileged point. And it's also rotationally invariant. It's homogeneous and isotropic. In 3D, I don't know how to draw it, but you can imagine that there is a concept of three-dimensional sphere, okay? Identified by the fact that the sum of all the coordinates, x1, x2, x3, x4, so sum where r is the radius. And then there is also, in bidimensional, there is also another kind of universe which are called the saddles. It's called hyperbolic spaces. They go like, a bit like this. It's the saddle of a horse, okay, or a mountain pass. And these are called H2. And again, there is an analogous in three dimension, an analogous plot in three dimension. So, since we live in three dimensions, we're interested in these properties where the universe is either completely flat or a sphere or an hyperbolic. Note that the sphere is finite. That is, if the universe was a sphere, there could be, it would have a finite size. Maybe very, very large, but finite. So this is the only example which we call it compact. So even, but if we live in 3D and we cannot draw it, how can we tell that which kind of curvature we have on the space? It is, these are called, by the way, these are called flat, these are called closed, and these are called open universes. And this we can tell because if you draw a triangle here, the sum of the angles alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, sum of alpha I for I that goes 1 to 3 equal alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3. This is in the flat space is 180 degrees, as the famous rule from the Greek. Now, he said that if you do it on a closed universe, it goes like this. A triangle looks a bit like this. So alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3, the sum is bigger than 180 degrees. And instead, in an open universe, the triangle will look like this. So alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3 is less than 180 degrees. So if you are a person living in this universe, you don't need to take a picture, make a drawing of the universe. You just draw a triangle, measure the angles, and you can decide in which kind of universe there are. Only these possible homogeneous universes are possible. There is no other one. Homogeneous and isotropics. Now, once it's a great help for us because once the universe is homogeneous and isotropic, then things cannot depend on x because every space is the same, every location is the same, or our angle because every direction is the same. Homogeneous means that every location is the same. Isotropic means that every direction is the same. So things are identified So if universe is homogeneous and isotropic, then everything is determined by a quantity which tells us the universe is expanding. So it tells us how much this surface has expanded from one time to another. And this quantity, how much the surface has expanded in a given location from one time to another, cannot depend on the location because nothing can depend on x. So this is called the scale factor, AOT. It tells us how much two coordinate points, two points that at t0 were distant delta x physical, the physical distance equal some distance, let's call it delta x initial, at 10t, defined themselves at a physical distance. So these two points are fixed on this say a point here or here, and a point here or here, and times evolve, and this ball becomes larger, this plane becomes larger. So they didn't move on the sphere, but they found themselves at a bigger distance, AOT delta x initial. So this AOT is what determines how much distance grows. When we see the galaxies receding from us, is this AOT that is making them recede. They don't move. The wood line not to move, but simply the space in between them is growing. between us and them is growing. Okay, this is very good for us. Okay, offers a simple picture. So, okay, it offers a simple picture of how things grow with time. So just to be very explicit, as AOT grows, this, for example, if the universe was a sphere, at the next time, this will be a bigger sphere, okay? So, I think. Now, it's very useful from an operational point of view, the fact that the universe is homogeneous, because this taming Einstein equations, which are some of the most complicated equations ever given to a physicist, become much simpler. They become, so, if a universe is homogeneous and isotropic, the equation becomes h squared equal g newton rho minus kappa over a square. Well, now I'm going to explain it. So h is defined as a dot over a. Now remember that a cannot depend only on time. It cannot depend on x. So this a dot is dA in dt, the time derivative of A over A. So notice that this H represents the time derivative of A over A, so it's the relative change of A in one unit time. It has H has units of 1 over time, and it's called Hubble rate. It has units of a rate, it's called Hubble rate. And it tells us how long it takes for the scale factor to double in time, to get an intuition how much it takes to double in time. Rho here is the energy density of matter. G newton is the same as this one, is the Newton constant. And this one is the factor curvature. This is equal to zero if we are in the flat case, this one here. Plus one if you are in the sphere, it's called closed case, this one. And minus one if it is in the open case, in the case of the hyperboloid, which is this one. Three dimensional, of course. So you can see that from this expression, anything depends only on time. There's no special dependence. And you can see that the role of curvature in each case is to carry some sort of energy. It's a bit like the energy, plays the same role of the energies with this peculiar form. And you can see that if I put zero, there is no effect from curvature. There is no curvature. If I put plus one, if I put a positive number here, it tends to make h decrease. H is the expansion rate of the universe. So a positive curvature means that the universe is trying to prevent the universe from expanding. It wants to let it go back. It makes the universe collapse. And instead, a open universe, it's minus one here, so it's a plus sign here. It makes the universe expand even farther and farther. So close curvature tends to prevent expansion. Open curvature tends to make it, prevent it. And observationally, we know that this number is very, very small. And so we know that for what all we care, we live in a very good approximation in a universe like this. We're kind of lucky. We could have lived in this way, and some of the triangles angles would not be 180 degrees. But it's an experimental fact that I will mention at the end of probably this class that we can see that this is very small. Now, the moment the universe expands, the moment the universe does statics, immediately, as I mentioned before, the question of how it started and where it's going emerges and needs to be addressed. And this is what we will start to do with the point of these classes. We'll show you what we know about, I'll try to show you what we know about how the universe started and also about the future of the universe, because both of these sides are unknown right now. And they exist as questions. Now, so in order to address this, we need to know what this matter, the energy density, does when the universe expands. So let's see. So let's imagine to have some form of dust. By dust we mean some form of matter, some matter whose energy is to a very good approximation given the mass. Sorry, I should say mass times the speed of light square, E equal mc square. Now we will, I don't know if I'm allowed to work, we usually work in units where we take the speed of light to be equal to one. And it's possible to take the speed of light to be equal to one because every time you get an expression which should be dimensionless and this has meter over time units, you know that it is because we took the speed of light to equal to one and so one should divide it by c. That is, one can work always with the speed of light equal to one and reinsert it at the very end. Or in other words, we are aliens and measure speed we measure matters and times in such that the speed of light goes at a velocity one alien meter per time alien time. Okay, there is also the kinetic energy, but let's assume that the kinetic energy is much less than the rest energy. Then in this case, basically we have some of these particles in a region. They don't move because the kinetic energy is totally negligible. Let's make it even zero. And the universe is, there will be a number density, which is a number of particles in a given volume. And as the universe expands, so this region gets larger, and clearly the number density dilutes in a way that such that the number density of time times the volume of a given time is constant. Particles didn't go anywhere, they didn't move, they simply got diluted into the region. This means, since in the universe the volume is as unit of length cube, and each length in the universe is growing by a, the volume grows proportional to a cube of t, which implies that n of t times a cube of t is constant. If I simply substitute this here, which implies that n of t is proportional to 1 over a cube of t. And the energy density, which was m, how much energy per unit volume, since each particle contains m as m mass, mc square mass, the energy density is m times the number of particles per unit volume. So this goes proportional to 1 over a cube. So if you take particles that are almost at rest, dust, the energy density of time is some energy density at time zero times a zero over a of t cube. So if where rho of t zero is the energy density that was contained at a zero. So as the universe expands, matter dilutes like 1 over a cube. There is another kind of matter. This is not the way all matter redshifts. For example, let's consider radiation. Also, radiation is interesting because we can see it, but also because it carries energy. So let's consider radiation. Now, radiation, as you know from quantum mechanics, if you take a photon, the energy of a photon is proportional to h bar over lambda, where lambda is the wavelength of the photon. Now, as the universe expands, the length between the distance between the wave fronts gets stretched. So lambda of t is proportional to a of t, which means that the energy of a single photon is proportional to 1 over a of t. Now, this means that the energy density in radiation, if you have a bunch of photons in a box, goes like the energy of the photons times the number density of photons. Now, the energy of the photon goes like 1 over A. The number density of photons, there are these photons in this box, the universe expands, they just go like 1 over the volume, so 1 over A cube. So the energy density goes like 1 over A to the fourth. So radiation, as the universe expands, dilutes, but dilutes much more quickly than non-relativistic matter. Okay, so this means that if you have a universe now, if we look at the universe now, and we look at the contribution of the various energy densities in the universe, as we go back in time, dark matter, for example, dust matter could be, for example, dark matter, matter that doesn't interact with light, but very slow. Dust grows like 1 over A cube. And radiation instead grows like 1 over A to the fourth. So this is a rho dust, and this is rho radiation. So if you go, there are two things to notice. First is that if radiation now is subleading with respect to in terms of energy, respect to dark matter, sooner in the past, sooner or later, it will win and becomes dominant in the early universe. So in the early universe, radiation is more important than dark matter. And the second is that if you go back in time, the energy density goes very large. And if you go to arbitrary time, A shrinks to zero side, rho goes to infinity, energy density becomes infinity. So at early times, early on, A of t goes to zero, rho of t goes to infinity, and when the energy density goes to infinity, our equations don't make sense. The reason why our equation don't make sense is because it's not because these mathematical equations don't make sense, but because to this equation, one should add quantum corrections. And once the energy density becomes infinite, in reality, once the energy density becomes larger than the so-called Planck density, this equation is not a good approximation to reality. And we don't know how to solve the equations when the energy density is close to infinity, or at least the Planck density. This is a work that string theory is supposed to do. And they're working on it. But this means that when this happens, the concept of space and time becomes ill-defined, okay? There is not really a space in which particles move, it's all mixed together. So this means that simply the fact that the universe expands means that in the past there is a singularity. So the universe started with a singularity. Which means even though you solve this equation with string theory, still space and time did not exist really. Okay, space time emerges at some point. Okay, and this is called the Big Bang. Big Bang is the time at which the universe started expanding like that. So this means, however, that there is only a finite range of times over which we can describe the universe. If this is now t0, if you go back in time, at some point our equations stop making sense. This is more or less when the universe was as old as 10 to the minus 43 seconds. And the current age of the universe is about 10 to the 13 gigayears. So about 10 to the 10 years. So we cannot describe the full history of the universe. We can describe this interval, which is still decently good, I think. I mean, OK. And it'll improve. But we'll never end. There will always be a before. So yes, thanks. Thank you for the question, by the way. Please, because I feel a bit lonely. Yes.
So conservation of energy still work? If you sort of allow for the fact that space is expanding, does it cancel out these decreases in energy density?
Yes, yes. There is a sense in which energy is conserved. So this is obvious. That's why you're asking, because this is much more tricky, right? Yeah, the reason why you can think that the energy is still being conserved here. Naively, it looks like it's not conserved. But because you can think that the universe is expanding. So if you take a box of space, when you have radiation, since the photon moves, they also induce pressure on the walls. So there is a pressure on the wall. So as the universe expands, this wall has moved from here to here. So there is a pressure, which is there is a work done by the radiation, which is the pressure times the delta x of the how much the wall moved. So if you put energy was lost, not only because of dilution, which then it's overall conserved, but also because some work was made to make the universe expand. Instead, in this case, there is no such event because the pressure is zero. Okay?
So this work done, where does that energy show up?
In the space. Is curving the space. No, the vacuum energy is not that. The vacuum energy is, I will explain it in next class. The vacuum effects, now please ask. So in a sense, you can think that this matter, loosely speaking, this matter is going to source this right-hand side here, that is a curvature of the universe. So the fact that the universe, in order for the universe to expand in the way in which radiation makes it expand, some extra work needs to be done.
You know, is it correct to say that it's the kinetic energy of expansion
Because the
work goes into kinetic energy of expansion?
Yes, the only thing is that, yes, you can think of kinetic energy, but it's negative kinetic energy. Exactly, because the universe with radiation is actually decelerating faster than with matter, so it's compensating the negative energy of gravitational field. Thanks. Now, okay, let's move on. Thanks, eh? So the universe started very, very, very dense. Now, when the universe is very, very dense, we will use another. You can see that the wavelength become very, very short. And clearly, things become very energetic. So also, things will interact. And the temperature, so things will interact. Particle will go in thermal equilibrium early on. And they will acquire a temperature. As you compress things, the temperature, as is intuitive, grows. So as early on, also the temperature grows. So as we go back in time, we can assign a temperature to to the universe, or to the radiation contained in the universe, and also grows. So the universe starts very, very energetic, very, very dense. And so the picture that emerges of the universe is the following. The picture is that the universe is the following. The universe starts very, very hot. And basically, let's start from now, and let's go back in time. The universe gets more dense. The galaxies get all crashed together. Then solar system get crashed together. Stars merge together. Atoms begin to merge, and they broke down. For example, if there is a proton and electron going around, energy becomes so large that the atom gets broken, and you get a free electron and a free proton. Then also protons smash together, and they get broken into quarks. So also proton hits another proton, very, very high energy, and they broke into quarks, up and down, as you saw in the last lecture. So So if you look at the universe as time goes on, the temperature drops, goes down, and the universe initially starts with a soup of the most elementary particle we have. For example, quark, up, down, electron, positrons, all the particle that are around, all the standard model. Or even the ones beyond the standard model, if they exist, because at early enough temperature, they were present. That's why cosmology also becomes a way also to explore the laws of physics that we don't know, because whatever are the laws of physics, very energies here, they're playing a role. But let's assume that there is only this kind of matter, the standard model matter. As time goes on, at a certain point, the temperature of the universe becomes, temperature here becomes 1 MeV at some time. 1 mega electron volt, where an electron volt, so 1 electron volt is 10 to the minus 19 joules. So when the temperature of the universe becomes 1 mega electron volt, the photons, the radiation, becomes at most as energetic as 1 mega electron volt. Now, if you look at what the kind of possible states in which an up a quark can be free, and there is some energy, up, down, two up and down quarks at rest. And then there is a bound state of two up quark and down quark. When they're bound together, we just call the proton. So if you put together three quarks, and the typical energy here is 1 MeV. So as soon as the universe becomes colder than 1 MeV, we are at high energies. Especially we are at energies. There are these up quarks that want to merge because clearly they gain energy merging. But there is immediately, so they make a proton, but immediately arrive a super energetic photon that destroys it. But at some point, the temperature of the universe drops because the universe is expanding. The temperature drops below 1 mega electron volt. And then there are no more photons to break the protons that are being formed. And so the protons begin, stays there. So this is, the quarks bind into protons. Similarly, there is also neutron, up, down, down, and so forth. Helium, which is two neutrons and two protons. So this epoch is called nucleosynthesis. So when the universe was about 1 MeV, or at the time of the universe was about 1 second, there is the epoch of nucleosynthesis. Nuclei forms. Then universe keeps expanding, energy keeps diluting, temperature keeps dropping. At a certain point, and here, what are the constituents of the universe? There are all the nuclei, like proton, neutron, a little bit of helium, lithium, but those are a very, very tiny fraction of the universe. So mostly proton and neutrons. And then, and also, of course, there are electrons. They were there from the beginning. Now, we can do the same kind of picture here for the electron. So again, the electrons, and if you take an electron and the protons, they can be free, and they have some energy. But also, they can bound into a bound state between a proton and an electron, which is called hydrogenon. Hydrogen. Sorry, this is the British accent. So this is hydrogenon. Symbolically, let's write like this. Okay, the energy difference between this and this, there is no need to be precise. I mean, it's 10 electron volt. Okay. So same story happens. Proton and electron here want to recombine, but there is a lot of photons, very energetic, that immediately ionize a hydrogen that is formed. But when the temperature of the universe becomes about 10 electron volt, a bit less, but doesn't matter for the purpose of this course, then there are basically a little bit below 10 electron volt, there are basically no photon big enough to destroy an hydrogen, and so hydrogen will form. So here we form atoms. Since most of the universe was protons and electrons, it formed basically almost 90% of matter is formed into hydrogen. This epoch is called recombination. And it happens when the universe was about 300,000 years old. So notice that it takes a long time. Here was 1 second, 300,000, okay. It takes a long time, but still very early with respect to the current time, which is 13 billion, billion years. So when this is a very important epoch. Is when hydrogen has formed. This will be the epoch over which we concentrate the rest of this class. Because what happened? Now, so what happened? Up to before recombination happened, there were what were the constituents? There were protons and electrons. Electrons, protons. They were going around, and there were many photons, and they were eating each other and keeping equilibrium, bouncing, boom, boom. And photon, we usually call it gamma. So they were eating each other, same with the proton, and et cetera, et cetera. As soon as, however, so these photons of all energies, because this is an interaction of a free electron with a free photon. And no matter how small is the energy of the photon can be kicked by the electron. So it can change direction, for example. From here, it goes there. Yeah, yes?
I have a question.
Yes, thanks.
If it's isotropic and homogeneous at that point in time, does everything just become hydrogen all right at the same time? Just boom. Do you see what I'm saying? Because it's isotropic and homogeneous. If it's the same everywhere, and in every direction.
Once
the first hydrogen atom forms, does just the whole thing just become hydrogen all of a sudden?
Yes. It's not like a chain reaction. In every place of the universe, it happens at the same time. Yeah. I think your question is very, very good because you are saying, I think, can I just elaborate on your question? I think a follow-up question to yours is this, but come on, how can be all the universe having this thing at the same time? I think it's a fair question to ask, and this will be a motivation for inflation, which we'll see in the next class. So it's a very deep question. But as it is now, the universe is homogeneous and everywhere happens at the same time, okay? That question will be the motivation for the second lecture. Okay, now, so before recombination, in every location of the universe, photons, no matter how little energy, were changing direction all the time because we're interacting with electrons and protons. But when recombination happens, basically all the electrons and protons are bound together into hydrogen, which is neutral. It doesn't have any electric charge. So the photon doesn't really see that it's neutral, so it doesn't see the hydrogen anymore. In reality, if you look at the energy levels of the hydrogen, it's true that a photon can interact with an hydrogen, but since the state of the hydrogen are quantized, only the photons whose energy is precisely at the energy level of the atom can interact with it because its energy is quantized. And it turns out that for our purposes, there are no such photons around at that time anymore. So all the photons have very low energy and they just travel freely. So these photons have nothing to do. So at this epoch, photons travel freely. Until when? Well, they start traveling in a straight line. At some point, there is a photon here, but proton and electron recombine just before it gets there. And it doesn't see the hydrogen and keeps going straight forever because it doesn't have anything to interact with. So it keeps going. It keeps going for 13 billion years. Okay. For this photon, this is called the last scattering point. Last scattering point. The It was a photon. Maybe here he found the proton. A photon came from here, interacted here, and then he didn't find any point anymore. So this photon traveled straight from this epoch when the universe was 300,000 years old all the way. So these photons, we can see them. This photon, we can see them. Why? Because, okay, let me reproduce this picture here. So there is a proton and an electron just recombined in time. A photon just barely touched them and then it didn't touch anymore and travels to us. Now we live here and we see this photon coming from there, which has traveled straightly to us for 13 giga years. And there is, now, this photon came, as we saw at the beginning, was emitted 13 giga years, and so it was not emitted here, because since it travels at the speed of light, it was emitted very far away. It was emitted at a location in the universe which is 13 giga light years away, a huge amount of distance, the distance light travels in 13 giga years. A photon from here, but there was also a photon from here, and a photon from here, and a photon from here. So there is a surface of a bidimensional sphere around us where photons are coming from each direction, which were emitted when the universe was 300,000 years old, and they travel for 13 giga years to us. This is called the last scattering surface. And it's a surface because by isotropy, photons come from every direction. There is not a privileged direction. The universe was isotropic and homogeneous. But notice that the points from which they come, they're very far. They're not here. So, but it's very useful, this because it's a bit like when we look at a cloud in the sky. That is, if you look at a cloud in the sky, and you are a guy here, this is an eye of a guy. Is watching. When the surface of the cloud is nothing but we have an impression of the surface of the cloud thanks to the last photon that scattered out of the cloud and traveled straight to us. So when we see a cloud, we look. The image of the cloud is the last scattering surface of the photons with the vapor in the cloud. So this surface here is the last scattering surface for the photons when we look at the night sky, at the cloudy sky. This is the last scattering surface, and therefore, as much as the cloud, seeing a cloud is a picture of a cloud, this one is called the last scattering surface and is the picture of the universe. Picture. Literally, the picture, like when we take a picture of the universe. When we take a picture of me, you get the photon directly from me to the camera. So this is a picture of the universe. When it was quite baby, 300,000 years old, which for the universe is small. So if the universe was very, very hot, there should be this radiation coming from everywhere like that. And this was found in 1965, a bit maybe likely, but they were very good with experiments, so they found it. And they built a very, very precise antenna. This radiation is very, very cold. It's very, very little energetic because it was emitted when the photons were more or less like 10 electron volts, and then they traveled for a long time. And in this time, the spatial of the universe stretched the wavelength so that it lost energies. So it's a very, very dim radiation. Star, galaxies have more radiation. But this is radiation that comes from everywhere. That's how they could find it, because it must come from everywhere. And indeed, they found it. Is a picture on the right, which can be interpreted in the following way. So as I said, it's a sphere. It comes from any direction. And to represent a sphere on a plane, to represent every point of a sphere on a plane, it's useful, like we do for the map of the world. We project it on the right on a plane, and similar there. So you can see, it surprises that it's simply a dull picture, but it gets a Nobel Prize. So it's not so dull. Because it's a picture which is the same everywhere, okay? They found this radiation. The temperature of this radiation, the intensity, is about 3 Kelvin, which means that the energy was about, each photon was about 10 to the minus 4 electron volt. So very, very dim. And they find that it was the same everywhere. And this was a huge surprise, okay? Yeah, thank you. Yeah, sorry. It's not the same everywhere apart from the white in the middle, which is the galaxy. Of course, if you look at the galaxy, there is a huge amount of radiation. And there is also radiation. Since it is so huge, usually much very energetic, it's so huge there is also a lot of low energy radiation. So the line in the middle, thanks, is that, which they cannot remove it, so they mask it. But all the rest, wherever they look, they find a temperature which is the same, which is, means that how much this photon traveled from this side and from this side was the same, because all photons were emitted at 10 electron volt, and we see them with the same wavelength everywhere, which means that they travel for the same amount of time, because as they travel, the wavelength grows like A. So the energy goes down like 1 over A. So, and this is why it's a sphere. Otherwise, if it was very anisotropic, it would be like, I mean, not right, but it would be completely deformed, like an ellipsoid, but completely deformed. So, and this, seeing this picture is beautiful. It explains that the universe started very, very hot, and had this process of recombination where all the protons and the electron recombine in hydrogen. So it's beautiful, but at the same time, it's terrible, because it tells us that the universe has a huge problem. It's the so-called horizon problem. It's a huge at this time, it was a huge mystery to explain why this radiation had the same temperature everywhere. Your question is why this last scattering surface was a perfect sphere around us. Now, we're going to explain in detail this problem. And in order to explain this problem, we have to go back a bit to the equations. So let's go back to the equations. Okay, we're going to explain the horizon problem. Okay, let's remind ourselves that h squared, the Hubble rate, was rho over n plus square. And let's forget about the curvature, which is very small. Now, given that rho goes like 1 over a cube, some initial rho is 0 cube over a of t cube. And since this Hubble square is a dot of t over a of t square, it's very easy to solve this differential equation. So we're going to solve a differential equation. So this is a, OK. It's not so hard, OK? It's not so hard. We'll do it. OK, so imagine, guess. OK, there is a trick. We guess the right answer, OK? So I guess that a of t is a0 times some power, t over t0 to the n. Then let's substitute here. A dot over a becomes a dot. This means that a dot, the time derivative, is a0 n over t0, t over t0 to the n minus 1 by applying the chain rule. So if I substitute there here, I get a square. Because I get a dot over a, so, okay. A dot over a, the zero simplify, so I get n over t. So, this equation here now becomes n squared over t squared equal rho zero a zero cube over a cube, which was a zero cube, t zero cube, t0 to the 3n, t to the 3n. Simply substituting this expression here and the answers for a here. Now you can see that the left-hand side goes like 1 over t squared and the right-hand side like 3n. So the solution, this must be the same at all times. So imply the only possibility is if this power, this dependence on time is the same as this dependence on time, which means 3n equal 2, which implies n equal 2 third. So if the universe is dominated by dust, this was dust, the scale factor of the universe, a of t, goes like a0 t over t0 to the 2/3. Notice that, so this is dust. We could repeat, and we solved a differential equation. So not all differential equations are hard. Now, if instead so you can see that the universe expands if it's solved by dust. It's a beautiful result. If it's expanded by dust, the expansion rate, the expansion scale factor of the universe goes like t to the 2/3. So it grows like this. And no, sorry, oops. More like this, 2/3. And in particular, h of t goes like 2/3/t. So it goes like 1/t. So the expansion rate of the universe, h of t, so this is a of t. And if I plot h of t, it goes like this, which is another reason why if I go to early time, the doubling time of the universe, it's infinite at the Big Bang, and we stop there. If there was a radiation, here it would be 1/8^4. Same exercise, tell us that a of t goes like a zero, t over t zero to the 1/2. So if this is the radiation. Okay, this we need this, why? Because we need to compute something called the particle horizon. So let's compute, what is the particle horizon? It's the thing that gives name to the horizon problem. It should be called the particle horizon problem. And now, if you consider, clearly light goes at a finite speed. It's not infinite. So if you take a point at a given, and the universe lasted for only a finite amount of time. So if the universe started, for example, at time here, when there was this space with this point here, by the time this t here and this is t initial, this point can have communicated only with a set of points which are inside the distance, the coordinate distance that for which light could have gone from this point to this point. Given that there is a finite amount of time here, this distance is finite. So at a given time, given that the universe lasted solely a finite time, there is only a finite distance over which I can talk, a person can talk to the others, or a molecule, a proton can talk to another proton. This is called the particle horizon. Let's compute it. Okay. Now, the light goes at the speed of light. So the fact that light goes at the speed of light means that the velocity of light, the physical velocity of light, let me just call the physical pH, which is how much a certain distance changes its time. This is the speed of light, which is C, which we call 1. Now, each point on this surface is labeled by coordinate x1, x2, x3. The physical coordinate, for example, and if you take the origin to be 0 here, the physical coordinate is how much is the distance between the origin and the point is not given by the coordinate simply x, because the universe expands. And the fact that there is expansion means that this physical distance changes with time. And the fact that it changes, even though the point doesn't move, and the fact that the distance changes with time is taken care by the scale factor. So the physical distance goes like the coordinate distance, x, times the scale factor, and grows with time, because the points get farther apart. This implies that the physical velocity goes like, so suppose that there is a photon, there will be a photon with some trajectory as time goes on. As time goes on, it will be a different point that we call x on t. And we define velocity to be the dx of t in dt, which is a coordinate velocity, which is not to do with the physical velocity, which is how much the physical distance changes with time. So by applying the shear rule, and this, given that this photon travels very, very fast, and the instantaneous velocity is not affected by the scale factor. The scale factor is almost constant instantaneously while the photon travels. So the velocity, the physical velocity is that d in dt of a x of t, and the time variation of this is much bigger than this, so we can neglect the time variation of a, and becomes a times dx in dt, which is a times b. Now, so this means that the coordinate if I launch a photon at the origin, at the beginning of time, as a function of time, the coordinate points that are touched, if this is x, that are touched by the photon, follow this equation, a dx in dt equal 1, which implies dx in dt equal 1 over a of t. Now we're going to solve also this differential equation. Okay, this is just an integral. The solution implies that the coordinate distance to points from the origin goes like the integral in dt prime from some initial time to some time of interest t of 1 over a of t. Very good. Now, imagine the universe just for fun. I mean, we can do it for any, that integral we can do for any a of t that we want, but initially the universe was dominated by radiation. It doesn't change much if you use matter. There was radiation. So we can use this a of t here, there. And this becomes the integral in dt prime of 1 over a 0 t to the 1 half t0 to the 1 half. These are time independent, t0 prime to the, t prime to the 1 half. These are time independent, so they go out of the integral. T0 to the 1 half over a 0. And then we have to do the integral dt prime of t prime to the minus 1 half. Now, to the of t prime to the minus 1 half. Now, I'm not good with integral, so I will drop any numerical constants. Just by dimension analysis, this is time times time 1 over t prime. So this goes like t prime, the t prime of, to the 1 half evaluated at t initial and the t of interest. I think there is a 1 half to put in front, but let's drop them. So this is equal to t0 to the 1 half of ray 0 times the time of interest to the 1 half minus the initial time to the 1 half. Now, this the initial time is extremely, we're interested in very, very long time, cosmological time. So this time is tiny with respect to this. So we can drop it. It doesn't matter that much. Which means that all this integral, all the contribution was coming from the upper part of the contribution. The lower part was not playing any role. So this is to a very good approximation, t0 to the 1 half over a 0 times t to the 1 half. Now, this means that the physical distance of t associated to the horizon, that is how much is the maximum distance can be traveled, the maximum distance can be traveled, of course, is traveled by light, which goes faster than faster than anybody else, is a of t times this x of t. And so a of t goes like a 0 times t over t0 to the 1 half. So this goes like a 0, there is one a 0, OK. So the 0 and the t0 simplifies, and it goes like t. Which, if you take a radiation-dominated universe, H, in a radiation-dominated universe, H is a dot over A. It's 1 half over T. So this quantity here is more or less 1 over the Hubble rate at the time of at the latest possible time. So this is important. Given that the universe had a finite age, there is a maximum distance over which there can be contact. Beyond a distance, this distance there has not been contact between two particles. This distance is given by, if the universe is always dominated by radiation, which is assumed when we plug AOT, this expression here, is given by 1 over the Hubble rate at the time, at the latest time. Now, this has a huge consequences because if you look back at the CMB, the CMB, last scattering surface, it was this surface here. And there were electron and proton recombining, and then photons starting from the recombination point. At the time, in each location here, the particle horizon, how much two objects could have talked to each other, the distance was the Hubble at the time, which in these units is here. It's smaller than the radius of this surface. Why is smaller than the radius of this surface? Because when we see the photon now, it means when we see the last scattering surface, means that we're looking at the photon coming from here and from here. This means that a photon coming from here and a comet coming from here, by now they can talk to each other. They talk at our location, which means the horizon now is indeed is 1 over Hubble now. And remember that Hubble goes like 1 over t, so it decreases with time. Hubble goes proportional to 1 over t if there is matter radiation. So the horizon now is much, much bigger than horizon at the same B. This is called cosmic microwave gamma radiation, so we call CMB emission. So in pictures, this is actually the horizon now, and all these regions are regions which were causally separated from one another. So there were all, this is the particle horizon. At the CMB time. And this is the particle horizon now. So that we see all these regions, because they're inside our horizon, and they start just talking to each other now. And when we look, however, when we look at the CMB, this region had never talked to this region, because there were more than horizons separated. How come they were at the same temperature? Therefore, why? They never talked to each other. Why? At CMB time, apparently causally disconnected region, apparently causally disconnected region, have same temperature, which is analogous to say why in all these regions recombination happened at the same time. So that picture was great, but it showed already at this level, the level of isotropy was about 10%, or I don't remember very well, but it was pretty isotropic. But clearly, if two regions never talk to each other, the temperature fluctuation you expect to be huge, orders of magnitude. They never talk to each other. Why they should? And the temperature in the universe changed by order of magnitude. It started with nucleosynthesis at mega electron volt. Here we're talking about 10 electron volt. These are actually 6 orders of magnitude change in temperature. So the universe started very, very hot, expanded a lot, and when Ta arrives here, temperature are within 1% of each other. We'll see that even more than 1% of each other. Yes?
We're still assuming homogeneous and isotropic and so on.
Yes, exactly, exactly. Well, yeah, fantastic, fantastic. Thank you. So either you're good or my job is good. I mean, I don't know. Yes, yes, exactly. So there are two, exactly. This raises a question. Now, cosmology, as I said at the beginning, is a peculiar subject. We cannot reproduce the Big Bang in the laboratory, so we're given an initial state, And with that initial state, we observe. So it could be that for some reason, the universe started with an extremely homogeneous state, even beyond causally disconnected regions. Started the universe everywhere homogeneous. Okay, that's a possibility. We cannot rule it out. That's one of the limitations of cosmology. We cannot rule out this possibility. However, it's a bit unusual because this universe starts from some quantum singularity. Why all the points which are completely disconnected should have started at the same time with exactly the same conditions and densities? So it would be much more appealing if you could find a way in which even though you start with an universe which is very inhomogeneous, there is a reason for which on these scales, the universe is homogeneous. In order for this to be the case, you need a way to homogenize the universe on these scales. But given that the scale, if the universe was always dominated by some form of radiation or matter, the horizon was this, the only way in which we can make a physical homogenization process happen is to change the horizon to make it actually bigger like this. The moment we make the universe with an horizon at the time of the CMB as big as this, maybe there is a chance for some physical mechanism to homogenize the different region, because now the region were in causal contact, so they talk to each other. Now, somebody very good homogenized them, some very good mechanism. In order to do that, we have to change the horizon, which means that you have to change the scale factor at some early times. And remember that the law, Einstein law, tells us that Hubble square is rho over n plus square. So we need to change how the scale factor evolves, we need to change how the energy density evolves at early times. This is what inflation will do in the next class, OK? Yes, exactly. You get the same for matter, apart from trivial order one numbers. They will not solve the problem. To solve the problem, you will need an AOT that goes to zero much, much faster at early time. So you see that this integral is dt over 1 over a. So if at early time 1 over a goes to zero very, very fast, then the initial contribution, the contribution from the initial times becomes very, very large. That's what inflation will do. OK, but before to get to inflation, there will be other observations that further motivate inflation, which is the evolution of the perturbations. OK, so let's talk. So because otherwise, like your colleague, maybe the universe started homogeneous. But we'll see that inflation is needed because even more is going on. The universe is even more unusual than what we found so far. So, but the natural picture that emerges of the universe is that the universe at the CMB was very, very inhomogeneous when it was 300,000 years old. But now the universe is quite inhomogeneous. For example, there are galaxies. You see the galaxies very, very clumpy. So there is a natural picture that emerges that the universe started very, very simple, with small perturbations, which are very, very small. In fact, Penzias and Wilson in 1965, they didn't see them. They're all, they see homogeneity. But maybe there are small fluctuations. And since energy density attracts other energy by gravity, with time, in the time between 300,000 years and 13 giga years, this energy density attracted an energy through gravity, grew, over density grew, until forming galaxies. So the picture that emerges is that the universe started very simple and became, through gravitational collapse, clustering, through gravitational growth, complex, and the galaxy was formed out of very, very small fluctuation early on, which is a very nice picture of the universe. Physicists, for many reasons. So let's summarize this picture. So, if this is the case, for this to be the case, it better be that there are small fluctuations early on. So immediately in 65, people read, OK, come on, there are small fluctuations in the CMB, and they grow with gravitational attraction to form these galaxies. OK, let's find these fluctuations. Maybe Penzias and Wilson were not sensitive enough. And they started looking. And then Kobe in 92 was a satellite who found them, and they also got the Nobel Prize. So it's pretty good. And they found that the delta T over T, the typical temperature fluctuation on the CMB, they found that the CMB surface was not isotropic. Different regions have a slightly different temperature. So coming back to your question, it was not quite true that the recombination happened every on a sphere around us. It was actually some point happened a bit earlier, in some point happened a little closer later, so that some point emitted light closer to us, and so they look hotter. Some point emitted light farther away from us, and so they look colder. Because light redshifts. All this radiation is emitted always at the same temperature. But if it's emitted from farther away, it travels longer, and so it looks colder. Yes, it was true. There was a small fluctuation, but just 10 to the minus 5. This is ridiculous, OK? I mean,
red is the galaxy.
Yes, again, thank you very much. So what is this picture is showing? The red is the galaxy. Thank you very much. So we are, these are satellites. They look at the sky. Clearly, they look from inside the galaxy. So as they look everywhere in the sky, sometimes they hit the galaxy. And everywhere they see the galaxy, they see a lot of light. And they clearly cannot see fluctuations over the 10 to minus 5. Fluctuation 10 to minus 5 is 1 per 10,000. OK, this room has maybe 100 people. It's like you remove a thousands of a person, and we notice, OK? That's the level, OK? So they couldn't see it. But as you go to the North Pole up or South Pole, then you can begin to see these fluctuations, tiny fluctuations, 10 to the minus 5, but there are. This was fantastic, because then this is the way structure form in the universe. This is how the universe formed. It's the confirmation. Small fluctuation became large through gravitational attraction. Now, in fact, once you see this, you measure very well. Kobe was the first experiment. Then we had, in 2010, the Brumapp, which measured more accurately this fluctuation. You see that there are many, many dots. It's measured very, very, very well. And then there is the most current experiment, Planck, which measured it exquisitely well. And you can see that there are these fluctuations whose typical size is about 1 degree on the sky. I tell you, it's 1 degree, that sky. The size of the dots is about 1 degree.
Between 1965 or whatever it was, and 2013, the galaxy disappeared.
So, yes. This was my sloppiness in Googling too fast. Yes. In fact, it's not true that Planck, this would be a major experimental achievement. This is, just for you, I tell you, it's a most likely reconstruction of what the fluctuations are inside the galaxy, given the correlation outside the galaxy. So it's very, anyway. But in fact, you can see almost an horizontal line there that tells you that it's not quite. But anyway, but you can see the precision evolved. This is a nice picture. So from Kobe 92, WMAP 2003, Planck 2003, it's like the digital camera. It improves incredibly well. So the picture that emerges is the following. At 300,000 years old, there were small fluctuations. They attracted gravity. There are more energy fluctuations. Because of gravity, energy attracts other energies, and they grow to form galaxies. We can see here. So take a point. This point is hot, attracts other energy. And because of energy, their matter falls in, and also baryons fall in. And then when they're very dense, stars ignite. Stars attract other stars. Galaxy form, you can see the galaxy, spiral galaxy there. So this is the picture that emerges of how the universe evolved from the CMB all the way to us. This, as you go from left to right, you can think in two ways. Experimentally, we never see the same point. As I explained at the beginning, each point we see all at a given time. So you can think of this as a fake evolution of the universe at a given point, but it is more or less what it should be, but we don't see directly. What we see is that we see the universe at different times, and at different times, we see that as we move from farther away to us, which means earlier times, all the way to us, which is later time, the structure gets formed. So this was an artist rendering. This is not true data. This is a movie. Now we're going to see directly the data, OK? We see that the picture that I shall show exists. We can reconstruct in the data. We will see that there is a picture where we, We'll do a very, very fast trip through the galaxy and beyond the galaxy, and we will see all the galaxies around us. And then as we go farther away, we'll see the galaxy disappearing because we're moving to earlier times. And then as we move farther away, we will find the cosmic microwave radiation, which is the earlier times. So these are all data points. This is not fake. It's not artist rendering. Now we are in our galaxy. We start flying all the way outside, very, very fast. Each point of the movie is a galaxy, seen by the Sloan Digital Sky Survey telescope. And you can see as we move further, so there are many, many galaxies. The universe is very big. You can see it's quite homogeneous, but there are structures. There are galaxies, and then there are clusters of galaxies and filaments of galaxies. Okay, it's not quite the same. There are voids and there are galaxies. But overall, the universe is statistically quite the same everywhere, more or less. I mean, there's no special. Doesn't look like there is a special play. No, these are true data, so there are some wedges, because the data were not taken everywhere. But you can fill the sphere your own. I mean, it's enough to conclude that the universe was the same. And then as we move farther away, we move to earlier times. There are no more galaxies; they didn't have formed yet, and we see the cosmic microwave radiation. The fluctuations, the universe there was very, very homogeneous, 10 to the minus 5. And the later times, where there are the galaxies, the fluctuations are of order 1. OK, so so this is very nice, I think. And so this means that the universe was, this is a major result. We understood how the universe, the mega structure of the universe formed. It's good. It's a result for mankind. I mean, it's not only, I mean, it's so basically, the CMB evolves all the way to the galaxy. How do I stop this? OK. Now, let's explain the part. Now, we're going to explain a little. So the CMB is not telling us only the fluctuations were very small. It teaches us much more. In order to explain how it teaches much more, and also to better understand this picture that gravitational clustering creates galaxies, we're going to study the perturbations of this universe, how they evolve. Because the universe was very, very simple initially, so it's very tempting to try to understand it mathematically. It's not that complicated. It looks almost homogeneous with 10 to the minus 5 fluctuations. Maybe we can do some calculation and understand it quantitatively. So let's study the cosmological perturbations. This is a slightly complicated subject. The point will be to analyze how those small inhomogeneities that we saw in the CMB evolve and grow with time to become the galaxies, OK? But I think we can do it in pretty simple terms. Now, early on, the universe was very, very simple. So it's a good approximation to write any field like the energy density that depends on space and time as a background energy density, which does depend only on time because as if the universe was only homogeneous, plus the small perturbations that depend on x and t. And the idea is that at least initially, delta rho over rho of x and t was much, much less than 1, was a very small number. This was 10 to the minus 5. At the CMB time. Now, this rho, in an homogeneous universe, there will be only rho 0 t. The homogeneous universe was homogeneous, but was evolving in time, which means that the universe was curved, because matter curves space-time, but was curved only in time direction, because it depended only on time. This field here, this fluctuation here, will also have overdensity space, maybe some more matter here, less matter here. So they will curve the space, not just the time. OK, we want to investigate the evolution of these perturbations. And in order to do that, we have to introduce a couple of concepts. First of all is the concept of plane waves. So any matter configuration, any configuration you can think of, you can write it as a superposition of plane waves. So it's very useful to just study the evolution of a plane wave. Well, imagine delta rho over rho. Let's consider a fluctuations, delta rho over rho of x and t, equal some amplitude that I call delta, which depends on some wave number k of t, times cos of kx plus phi of k. So this is a wave. It is a, let's plot it as a function of x. Let's imagine there is only one special dimension. So this would be kx, if it is a special dimension. Basically, this tells you that delta rho over rho it has some amplitude called delta of t at some given time, which depends on the mode. And then there is a cos of kx plus a phase. So this is a cosine. The wavelength of the cosine is 1 over k. 2 pi doesn't matter for the purpose of this class, OK? So this is useful to consider this because for two reasons. First of all, any initial configurations of matter can be decomposed in plane waves. And second, when the fluctuations are very, very small, the theory is practically linear, and any wave evolves independently. You might remember this familiar from electromagnetism, where the theory is linear and all waves evolve as a super independently, and any configuration of electromagnetic field can be written as a superposition of plane waves. Same is here. That just follows from linearity. And if the fluctuations are small, the fluctuations satisfy linear equations, so we will solve each wave at a time. Now, then, so these are plane waves, and then there is the ratio with Hubble. Ratio of wave number. So the concept we need to do is ratio of wave number to Hubble. So this wave number is how long it takes in x coordinate space to make an oscillation. So it's remember that however x physical, the physical distance is a of t times x. This means that if in a delta x, in order to change the oscillation by 2 pi, do a complete oscillation of this cosine, I need a delta x over the 1 over k, maybe 2 pi over k, but let's forget the pi, the 2 pi, which means that this wave number k is the wave number of the coordinate, wave. The physical, and it goes like 1 over the lambda, the wavelength in the coordinate space. But the physical distances are a times a coordinate distance, the physical wave number, how much it takes physical coordinate to go to how much you need to change physical coordinate to make it an oscillation is the wave number over a. So the physical wave number is k over a. And it's a very important quantity to understand the evolution of this perturbation ratio. The very, very important is the ratio k physical over Hubble as a function of time, which is k over a of t from this times Hubble of time. So this ratio has two possibilities. Either to be much bigger, much less than one, or much bigger than one. And when it's much less than one or much bigger than one, the regimes of the evolution of the perturbation are completely different, as we're gonna now see. In fact, when k over ah, how does this k over h evolve in time? So let's consider a plane wave. Let's imagine that there is a matter. L time, as I said, radiation redshifts much more quickly than matter. That's now that immediately after the CMB was emitted, the amount of radiation in the universe was diluted, and most of the matter energy in the universe was given by this dust. So let's imagine the universe is full of dust, because we want to understand how from the CMB we go all the way to galaxies, OK? So A of t, as we derived before, goes like t to the 2/3. So h, which is a dot over a, just by units, goes like 1 over t. So k over ah is k over t to the 2/3 times t, so it goes like t to the 1/3. So as a function of time, it goes like this. And at some point, it becomes 1. So this is time such that k over ah is 1. And in this regime here, k over ah is much less than 1. There is a region where it's order 1. We will not solve for that. And there is a region here where k over ah is much bigger than 1. It's possible to solve them in these regimes, simply these two regimes. Now, let's do it. So let's consider for k over ah much less than 1. This means this is the situation where the wavelength of the mode is way, way longer than Hubble at the given time. So, but the Hubble rate at a given time is the distance over which two points can have talked. It's the horizon that we just studied before. It's the physical horizon. If radiation is dominating the universe, is 1 over h. This means that the region where a point can fill another point is of order h to the minus 1, because beyond that point, they didn't talk to each other. And clearly, if you take this wave, the variation of this wave is much, much longer than the Hubble. So, and since physics is local, it's only the horizon, the fields contained inside the particle horizon that matter. For all practical purposes, this region and this region, delta rho over rho, is space independent. Because the variation is tiny. We can make it very, very small. So this means that this spatial variation here is, for all practical purposes, not spatially varying. So it's like a rescaling of the background. So the distance between this and this was that this was spatially varying. But if I can, there is no way to fill the spatial variation. It's just a rescaling. It's just as if the universe here locally was a locally unperturbed universe, just with rho locally, rho local of x, call this point x star, of x star is, to very good approximation, rho 0 t plus delta rho of x star t. So it just, and let me call it this, it's just a new function of time. But if rho was just a function of time, we know how it evolved. So this implies that delta rho of x and t must be proportional to rho of t, rho 0 t, with a time-independent constant. So this implies that delta rho over rho of x and t for k over ah much less than 1 is time independent. So if I plot it as a function of time, let me consider a certain wave number whose amplitude is delta k of t, delta k of t, and say that this wave number crosses, becomes, the physical wave number becomes longer than Hubble at k over ah this time here. At early time, it did not depend on time. Because delta rho over rho is delta k, which is time independent. Things change, however, when the mode become shorter than Hubble. As time goes on, k over ah as time goes on, K over H starts from here at early time, but at some point becomes much, much bigger than, much, much bigger than one. And then then we're talking about the mode in a different regime. Now, this is the Hubble length. And the mode is very, very smaller. The wavelength is much, much smaller than Hubble. Now, a beautiful principle of general relativity, which almost explains everything, is that at small distances, general relativity becomes, and small velocities, and this dark matter doesn't move at all, general relativity becomes Newton gravity. So here we're talking about distances much, much smaller than h, which is the curvature of the universe. So the equation that govern the system, and we're talking about small velocity, are Newton equations. So we all know what the Newton equations are. Laplacian of phi equal g Newton over 2 rho. So this is Newton equation. This is the continuum. This is called Laplace equation for phi. This phi is the gravitational potential, Newton. I mean, we're still doing generativity, but a short distance it's extremely good approximation to use Newton dynamics, gravitational field on Newton. This is the continuum generation when we say phi is a sum over the particle of g Newton, the mass of the particle r minus ri, where the sum over all of the particle I. The continuum version of this is this. Now, we're interested, the phi will have, the gravitational field will have a background gravitational field just due to the spatial, the background expansion of the universe, and a fluctuating gravitational field due to these delta phi perturbations. And then there will be also the rho will be the background a 1 plus delta, where delta is delta rho over rho. Now, if you substitute this here, we obtain Laplacian of phi 0 plus Laplacian of delta phi equal rho 0 g Newton 1 plus delta. OK, let me just write delta rho over rho. Now, in the absence of delta rho over rho, there is only phi 0, and this must be equal to the background. So this simplifies with this. And we get that Laplacian of delta phi, how much the fluctuation in the gravitational field are g Newton times rho 0, actually over 2, of delta rho over rho. Now, remember that Hubble Einstein equation was Hubble square equal g Newton rho 0, and actually there is over 3, to be precise. So this number here is equal to 3 over 2, Hubble square delta rho over rho. So this equation tells us that if you have a delta rho over rho in the universe, there is a gravitational field that is sourced by this delta rho over rho and is given by this equation. I think we're running out of time. In next class, we will, this tells us how delta rho over rho sources gravity. We cannot solve yet the system. We have to see still how delta rho over rho evolves. Next time we will see how delta rho over rho evolves. And then we will see exactly that delta rho over rho grows with time. And basically, starting from small fluctuation at SMB, we form growing over densities that form the galaxies. A beautiful result that emerges just from the calculation will be that the structure of the universe form from first will form the small galaxies and then the bigger galaxies. And the biggest galaxies are forming now, the cluster of galaxies. This we will see the next time and must come from the calculation. And then we will move on to explaining the physics instead of the cosmic microwave background. And then we will be ready in the remaining part of this class to study the theory of inflation, which will allow us to see two things. First, that the horizon problem will be solved. Second, it will be a source for these small perturbations. It will beautifully provide the initial condition for these perturbations. And there will be interesting surprise of interconnection between gravity and quantum mechanics that will happen in next class. Okay, thanks for the attention.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.